Hello students, hope so you're well and fine. In this lecture, I'll be discussing a topic on interstate cap and floor. Okay, interstate caps and floors. For whom this lecture is? So what is, for whom? Who is the audience for this lecture? It is a PG students who are having a finance paper or finance as a subject, or they are specializing in finance papers such as corporate finance, international finance, corporate finance in international context, international financial management, financial risk management. So these are the various papers which is related to this topic. Okay, even all the subjects will cover the same topic. Okay, and for UG students, those who are having a paper called financial management. So let me get into the topic first. So you have heard it. Term called derivatives, right? Already you are familiar with the term financial derivatives. The purpose of a derivative tool is to hedge risk. You all know that, right? The purpose of the derivative tool is to hedge risk. Hedging risk is nothing but what? Transferring your risk or reducing your risk. Okay? Normally in a capital market and financial market, normally there are a lot of capital intermediaries, okay, such as your broking firms, your banks, your insurance companies, mutual funds. You have a lot of other investors, foreign portfolio investors. Those are normally risk bearers and risk transferers. Okay, those financial institutions may be a risk bearer or a risk transferer. Okay, this is like a multiple chain, because every financial institution cannot bear huge amount of risk. So they will be transferring their risk depending upon the need arises, right? So the chain goes on. Okay, so the risk cannot be eliminated. This is very, very important. Risk cannot be eliminated. Risk can be transferred or it can be reduced, right? So for example, an insurance company, you are getting an insurance, okay? You are getting an insurance, say sum assured of 10 lakh rupees, you are having an insurance and you are paying a premium to the insurance company. This is an insurance company, okay? You are paying a premium to the insurance company. Why you are paying a premium to the insurance company? Because what is risk? What is the risk you are transferring? You are transferring your life of your risk. How much period I'll be surviving, or something happens to me, what will happen to my family, or what will happen to my dependent when I'm not there? So you are transferring your life's risk to a financial institution. The financial institution takes care of your dependent's risk of loss. So the bearer of loss is insurance company, right? So the thing is very simple. For that you have to pay a price called premium, okay, because the insurance company bears the risk of loss of your life. For that you will be paying a price called premium, right? So anything happens to you, the risk will be taken by the insurance company. So this is the main aspects of what this derivative is all about. So when it comes to the real markets, or we can say that when it comes to the capital markets, we'll be seeing about a term called OTC derivatives. OTC derivatives. So OTC derivatives is nothing but over the counter derivatives. Over the counter derivatives. Over the counter derivatives is nothing but it's a platform where the financial instruments are traded. Okay, financial instruments are traded in a customized way. Here you are not trading in stock exchange, because there is no standardized contract between any two parties. It is a customized contract between any two parties. You have already familiar with this. Okay, now what are the derivative instrument tools which are traded in OTC market? We have cap, floor, collar, we have forward rate agreements, forward rate agreement. We have interest rate swaps, interest rate swaps. We have swaptions. Swaptions is nothing but the combination of swap and option contract. You have already in your previous topics, you have already learned on types of derivatives. That is, types of derivatives what? Forwards, futures contract, forwards contract, option contract, swaps. These are your type of derivative instruments. Okay. In those derivative instruments, these instruments are normally traded in over the counter market. Right. It is not traded in stock exchange. These instruments are not traded in stock exchange. You should remember that. Since these are only in risk instrument tool, or I can say that these are the hedging instrument tool for protecting your risk. Right. Then we have currency swaps. Currency. Then we have forward contracts. In upcoming lecture, I will be giving a more detailed view on forward rate agreement. Then we'll be discussing on interest rate swaps, swaptions, currency swaps, forward contract with examples. So in this topic, we'll be discussing only on cap, floor and collar. The term cap, floor, collar. So cap is nothing but it's your interest rate cap. Interest cap. Then this is your interest rate floor. Then this is your interest rate collar. Cap is a type of derivative instrument, or I can say that it's an option type of derivative instrument. Option type of derivative instruments. Floor is also an option type of derivative instrument. The same way, collar is a combination of cap and floor. Right? So, it's a combination of cap and floor. Now, coming to a simple example, okay, let me put you into some simple example. Suppose you need a loan, okay, you need a loan. First, where you will be going to approach? You will be approaching a bank, right? So, it is you, right? You are approaching a bank for a loan. The bank will be providing you the loan. Say, you need a loan of, say, $100 million. You need a requirement of $100 million of loan. The bank gives you the $100 million of loan. But for this, getting this loan, you have to pay the price for the loan. That price is what? The interest amount. Assume that you have taken a loan of $100 million for a period of 7 years. Right? And you have to pay the interest amount to the bank. Now, when you are having a loan agreement with the bank may mandatorily decide the rate of interest at which you have to repay their interest amount, or you will decide, the option will be given by the bank at what rate you will be paying the interest amount to them. Normally, the agreement between the party and the bank, okay, the agreement between you and the bank of paying interest rate may be fixed mandatorily by the bank, or you will be fixing the at what rate you will be paying interest amount to the bank. The interest rate could be a fixed rate of paying interest amount, or it could be floating rate of paying interest amount. Floating rate of paying interest amount, right? So you may be giving a interest amount of fixed rate or floating rate. Okay, so as now, when it comes to interest rate caps and floor, normally you'll be fixing on the floating rate. So floating rate comprises of what? It's a benchmark interest rate. Floating rate is the floating rate interest rate is assigned to the benchmark interest rate, or we can say it as benchmark rate plus some basis points. Benchmark rate plus some basis points. So what is this benchmark rates? If you are an Indian customer, the bank may refer the benchmark rate to be MIBOR, that is Mumbai Interbank Offered Rate. Suppose you are getting a loan from a foreign bank, the bank may benchmark your floating rate to a LIBOR. It depends upon the loan you are getting from the bank. Okay, floating rate are normally decided by the bank, and you don't have to have that option to choose. Maybe there are some agreement where you have been given options to choose the interest rate, whether it's a fixed rate or floating rate, and at what rate you're going to repay your interest amount. Now, LIBOR is nothing but London Interbank Offer Rate, right? LIBOR is London Interbank Offer Rate. Hope you're clear. So, London Interbank Offer Rate, in past, this is decided by British Bankers Association. British Bankers Association. Normally, they decide the interest rates in past. Now, there is some other committee, Benchmark Interest Committee, Benchmark Committees, those who have taken now and they are deciding the LIBOR rates. In past, it was British Bankers Association who will be listing out that daily rates at 11 a.m. daily. Okay. So, it depends upon the rate, depends upon the average rate of past 5 years. It could be the average rate of interest rate of past 10 years or 7 years, depending upon the interest rate, which is interest rate risk, which is prevailing in the market. Right? Now you are familiar with what is floating rate, right? Floating rate is nothing but the benchmark rate plus basis point. So come to next topic, the same thing. You are a borrower. You are getting a loan of say $100 million from the bank, and you have decided, you both have come to an agreement that you will be paying the interest amount by paying an interest amount of floating rate. You people have decided that the floating rate interest rate will be repaid to the bank. Now the floating rate is nothing but your LIBOR rate. Assume that the LIBOR rate is 8%, okay, and you have got a loan from the $100 million bank for a period of say 7 years, right? You are a borrower and another party is a banker. LIBOR rate is 8%, right? This is a floating rate, which is a benchmark rate. You have decided that you will be repaying the interest amount at a floating rate of 8% LIBOR rate, okay, for a period of, say, the LIBOR rate, maybe the period differs, okay, it may be a 6 month LIBOR rate, it may be a 1 year LIBOR rate, it may be a 2 year LIBOR rate, or it could be a semi-annual compounding LIBOR rate, or it depends upon the agreement. Normally quarterly rates are more prevailed because the loan amount is for a short period, right? This is our managing risk for a short term. Normally for academic purposes I am using 7 years, long years for explanation, but in real markets, those loans are taken for a short period, okay, because to manage risk, right? Now for academic purpose I am explaining this, then we'll be getting further lectures, I'll be telling you more on a more practical way how it operates. Now you are a borrower, you're getting a loan of $100 million for a period of 7 years from the bank, and you bank and the borrower has come to an agreement that the borrower will be paying an interest rate which is fixed at floating rate, which is a LIBOR rate, now which is running at 8%. So assume that every year you have to repay your interest amount to the bank. Assume, I'm academic purpose, I'm telling you for conceptual purposes. Say at the end of first year, at the end of second year, at the end of third year. Assume that at the end of first year, the LIBOR rate comes down to 6%. At the second year, at the end of second year, the LIBOR rate comes to, say, 4%. At the end of third year, assume that the LIBOR rate comes to 12%. Right? So, you have decided that you have had a contract with the banker. At every end of year, you will be paying interest amount at this rate. Now, already you have chosen a floating rate. Under first year, you had agreement with the banker that you will be paying a LIBOR rate of 8%. When at the end of first year, the floating rate, which is the fluctuating interest rate, has come down to 6%. So you will be paying interest rate only 6%, not 8%. So you will having a benefit of not paying 2% amount. So it is better for you, na? So 8% you will not be paying at the end of first year. 6% of interest amount you will be paying. So there is a benefit to you. When it comes to end of second year, again the LIBOR rate from 8% it comes to 4%. So in first year, you are having a saving, right? So 6% only the interest amount you are paying to the bank, and 2% is a gain for you. 2% is a gain for you. So total comes to 8%. So you are paying interest amount only for 6%, not 8%. 2% is a saving for you. In the same way, when it comes to second year, the LIBOR rate comes down from 8% to 4% at the end of second year. Right? Now, you will be paying the interest rate to the banker at 4%, where extra 4% is a gain to you. As a borrower, you will be paying only 4% interest rate. So, out of total 8% of the floating rate, you will be paying only 4% of interest rate to the banker, and you will be gaining a 4%, which is a savings for you. So, as a borrower, it is more helpful for you. What happens, suppose the floating rate goes above 8%. In the third year, the scenario changes. Now, the LIBOR rate fluctuates to 12%. Already, you have an agreement with the banker that you will be paying a floating rate of 8% to the banker. Now, at the end of third year, it is a burden for you. Now, 8% of interest rate amount at the end of third year will be paid to the banker, plus 4% extra burden will be paid to the banker, where you will be paying a banker 12% of interest amount at the end of third year. At the end, you will be paying in 12% of interest to the banker. So who is a loser over here? You are the loser, because you are the borrower and banker is the beneficiary, right? Borrower, you are bearing a loss, extra loss of how much? 4%. Okay. Now there is a fear in your mind. What will happen, suppose my interest rate will go above, because you have an agreement with the banker that it is a floating rate interest payment, you have agreement with the bank. Now it becomes a loss for you. For protecting this loss, as a borrower, you will buy an derivative instrument, that is option type of derivative instrument, called interest rate cap. Interest rate cap. So you'll be buying an instrument called interest rate cap. You're buying a derivative instrument called, you're buying, in simple I can say that, you're buying an option. Okay, it's an option. While buying the option of interest rate cap, you will be given a right, but not an obligation to exercise the option. You are given a right. So if you're more not familiar with option type of contract, please see my previous lectures on options, where you'll be more familiar with what is option contract, right? Now you're buying in right, you're buying interest rate cap, right? Assume that you are a borrower. We know you are a borrower. Okay, you have got a loan of $100 million from a bank for a period of 7 years, and you have decided to pay LIBOR rate to the bank. Okay, depending upon the interest rate, which is fluctuating in the market. Okay, now you are more familiar with it. Now, it is seen that at the end of third year, you have predicted that your 8% of LIBOR rate will rise to 12%, where you have to bear an extra loss of 4%. This is your extra loss that you have to bear. You are the risk bearer now. Yeah. So 4% of loss from the borrower. Now, to hedge this risk, you are purchasing an interest rate cap. Right? You are purchasing an interest rate cap for this one. For that, you have to pay a premium to the interest cap seller. In the same way, you have to decide the cap rate. At what rate you will be fixing the interest rate? Say, assume that normally 8% the LIBOR rate, the cap rate you have fixed with the cap seller. Now you are the cap buyer. There will be a cap seller, cap buyer, and cap seller. The cap rate is 8%. Now, this 4% loss will be beared by the cap seller. Now, assume that at the end of third year, the 12% rate of interest has to be repaid to the bank. But you have already purchased an interest rate cap, which is an interest rate option. It's an option contract of interest rate cap. And you have purchased the interest rate cap at the rate of 8%. It means that if above 8% my LIBOR rate increases, if suppose above this cap rate, suppose my LIBOR rate increases, the extra loss bearing interest rate will be bear by the cap seller. Now, nothing simple, sir. See, the same example. You have already fixed a strike rate. It's nothing but option type. You have a strike rate. Strike rate for option contract. For this, it is a cap rate. When your interest rate goes above 12%, now you will be exercising this option because it is unfavorable to you. So this extra 4% of loss will be beared by the cap seller. Okay, for the banker, you can pay only 8% of interest amount. The extra 4% of loss will be taken care of cap seller, or he will be compensating the loss. He will be compensating the loss of 4% for you. So for the banker, you will be paying 8%. The extra compensating loss will be given by the seller. So he'll be supporting you or compensating your loss. This is the concept of interest rate cap. Coming to interest rate floor. So what is this floor? The floor is opposite of your cap. For floor, suppose that you want to deposit an amount. You are a depositor. You're going to deposit in a huge amount, or you are an investor. You're going to do some investment. Okay, so say suppose you are investing say an amount of 1 lakh. So what will be your main idea in your mind which is running? Whether you want to get a higher end rate of interest or lower rate of interest. Normally, for an investor or a depositor, he wants higher rate of interest. He does not want the lower rate of interest. Okay, suppose the LIBOR rate is 8%, and you have said that I am going to deposit a particular amount of 1 lakh, and I've decided that my interest rate should be according to the LIBOR rate which is prevailing in the market, which is at 8%. Suppose the LIBOR rate increases to 12%, the bank will pay you extra 4%. 8% will be the interest payment you will getting, and extra 4% will be paid to the bank because this is a floating rate. So you'll be getting 12% interest amount on your deposited amount. Now this 4%, extra 4% is a gain to you. In previous cap, this extra 4% is a loss to you because you are a borrower. In this, you are a buyer, right? You are a buyer, or you are a depositor, or we can say that you are a lender of money. Right? So these are the main thing. Now, this is a gain for you. What happens? Suppose the interest rate goes below 8%. Suppose it comes to 6%. You have deposited an amount that you'll be getting an 8% of interest rate. What happens at the end of third year? Suppose the interest rate comes down to 6%. What will happen? You will get only an interest rate of 6% on your deposited amount, or the amount you have lend the money to the borrower. Suppose you are a lender, if your interest rate comes down, you are getting only a low interest amount from the borrower, right? From a depositor point of view, from a lender point of view, right? Everything is same, so think in a logical way. Now, 2% is a loss beared by you. So normally you are getting a labor rate of 8%. When it comes, when at the end of third year, if market pulls down to 6% of interest rate, 2% you will not get. You will get only 6% of interest amount. So how much loss you are paying? 2% of loss amount you are paying. This is for this purpose, to protect this loss. Okay, you are a floor buyer. You will purchase a interest floor, interest rate floor. You will buy a floor from the floor seller. Floor seller, and you are a floor buyer. Okay, because this is an hedging instrument, so you'll be buying a interest rate floor. Floor seller and floor buyer. So for that, say, I assume that a cap rate is fixed at how much? 8%. Cap rate is fixed at 8%. Now this extra 2% loss will be beared by the floor seller, right? Now summarizing this to cap rate, floor, collar. Cap is an option type of contract. The same way floor is an option type of contract. Collar is a combination of cap and floor. Cap, interest rate cap is purchased by whom? By the borrower. Floor is purchased by the depositor or the lender or the investor. Here a commission has to be paid as a premium to the cap seller. Here the commission has to be paid as a premium to the floor seller. Here no commission to be paid. When it comes to cap, LIBOR rate 8% is there. This will be your cap rate. For a borrower, what happens? The borrower will be afraid that if the interest rate goes beyond my LIBOR rate, I will be bearing a loss. Suppose, say that it increases to 12%, you will be bearing a loss of 4%. 4% loss. Because, see, you are a borrower, you are paying an interest amount of 8%. At the end of first year, the LIBOR rate becomes 12%. You have to pay the interest amount of 12%, not 8%. So extra 4% of loss you have to bear. For that, you are purchasing an interest rate cap, and this cap, this loss will be compensated by the cap seller. For that cap seller, you are paying a commission which is called as option premium. Right? The same way, when it comes to floor, LIBOR rate is 8%, which is also a cap rate. Cap rate is nothing but strike rate. So when you have a fear in your mind, you have fear in mind, suppose my interest rate falls below 8%, it becomes 6%, you have to bear a loss of 2%. What is the loss you are bearing? You are not getting 2%, extra 2%, right? No, you are getting only 6% of interest amount. This 2% of loss will be bear by the floor seller. Hope so the concept is clear. See, in the next lecture, I'll be getting with the problems, so that working on those problems, so it become very, 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 very easy for you to take care of this topic. Now coming to collar. Okay, the last topic of this lecture, collar. Collar is a combination of cap and floor. Okay, here no commission to be paid. So let me give you a very simple example on collar. With this I finish this lecture. Okay, it takes a lot of time now. Collar. See, assume that the same example we'll take. Collar is a combination of cap and floor. See, you are a borrower. You have taken a loan from the bank for $100. $100 you have taken a loan from the bank, and you have decided that you will be paying interest amount of LIBOR rate at 8%. Right? Now, if the LIBOR rate increases to say 10% at the end of first year, suppose the LIBOR rate increases to 10%, how much loss you will be bearing? You will be bearing a loss of how much? 2%. 2% of loss will be bear by you. Okay, this 2% of loss will be compensated by collar seller. Collar seller. Right? Now, since this is a collar is a combination of cap and floor, again the contract continues. So this loss will be compensated by collar seller. In cap, it's only a cap seller who is compensating you the loss. Now, this is a combination of both. Now, a collar seller will be compensating the loss of 2%. In the same way, suppose this LIBOR rate falls down. LIBOR rate falls down to 6%. What will happen? Because you are having both cap as an option contract, floor as an option contract. So you are acting as a borrower and lender in the same way. Right here, you are acting as a borrower and lender in the same manner. So you may be having a portfolio of interest rate options. You may be having multiple options or multiple agreements or multiple rate of options you may be having in your portfolio. Right? So depending upon that, you will be using the hedging tool. So collar is a combination of cap and floor. Maybe you are a portfolio manager, or you may be a treasury manager, will be having a lot of portfolios of contract within your bundle of your managing your portfolio, right? For that, you may be buying this hedging tool called collar. Now, suppose the LIBOR rate falls down to 6%. Now, when the LIBOR falls down to 6%, as a floor, as a part of a floor, you will have a gain of 2%. Right? So, see, you are a borrower, right? You are a borrower. When it comes to a fall of 6%, you will be paying an interest rate, interest amount of the interest amount of only 6% to the banker. 6% of interest amount to be paid to the banker. So, you are having a gain of 2%. Right? Now, this 2% gain has to be shared with the collar seller. This 2% of gain will be shared with the collar seller. Okay, it may be the sharing of amount could be 50% of 50% of your 2% gain. So which comes to 1%. So a 1% of profit or 1% of gain will be shared with your caller seller. So this is a concept of caller. Right? Hope you are more clear on this topic on cap, floor and caller. If you have any doubt, please again see the lecture. And if you have any doubt, just comment me or give me a message so that I can give you more clarity. Next lecture, we'll be seeing on problem, working problems on interstate caps so that you have a strong command in this concept of interstate caps and floors. Thank you.